So welcome to this second lecture devoted to model selection. Today we shall talk about the Gaussian framework for model selection, and we shall focus on the issue of selecting linear models. So first of all, I would like to say some words about Gaussian processes. Remind you some facts that you know, and probably also introduce you to some facts that you don't know. So first of all, what is a Gaussian process? So Gaussian process, in full generality, is a collection of random variables where the parameter small t belongs to some abstract set of parameters, capital T. And when you see things like that, it's equivalent to consider some random variable as the map into R to the power capital T, which is equipped with the sigma field generated by the cylinder sets. That is a collection of a product of a collection of Borel sets which are trivial except for a finite number of them. So the law of this random map is determined by the collection of all marginal distribution. When I say all marginal distribution, I mean all finite dimensional marginal distribution. That is, we look at the distributions of random vector xt1, xt2 up to xtn, when this collection of finite number of t varies. The process now is said to be Gaussian if all these finite dimensional random variables are Gaussian. So this is clear. This means that all the vectors we see here are supposed to be Gaussian random vectors, or equivalently, the linear combinations of their components here are one-dimensional normal variables. Here we shall essentially address the case of centered Gaussian processes, since non-centered Gaussian processes are simply centered one shifted by a constant. So it's important to discuss first and to analyze first the centered Gaussian processes. So there is an important quantity to look at when you are studying the Gaussian processes in full generality. It is the L2 pseudo distance, which is naturally associated with the process and which is merely the L2 distance between the x of x and x of t. So of course, it's a pseudo distance and not exactly a distance because you do not necessarily separate points. Okay, but apart from this, you have a quantity which looks like a distance. And so it is a pseudometric. The parameter space equipped with d is a pseudometric space. So the major issues that we want to address is to get some tail bounds on the suprema of a Gaussian process and simultaneously discuss the fact that it is almost surely bounded, or if the process has almost surely continuous paths on the set of parameters equipped with this pseudo distance. And all these issues are closely related, as we shall see. So unfortunately, there are unavoidable measurability issues in this business, because it may happen that this soup of a process is not measurable. And so you have to take this into account and to think about it a few seconds. So we shall try to discuss this once for all. And the main point is that to avoid these problems, we shall assume that the set T is separable. If T is countable, there is no problem because the quantity which is the soup of XT here in the countable case is always measurable, of course. And the integrability of this quantity is equivalent to the integrability of its positive part because the negative part is always okay. So this means that you have always the sense to give to the expectation of the soup, which is either equal to a finite quantity or to plus infinity. So in the countable case, there is no issue. Everybody is measurable and you can always speak of the expectation of the soup. Otherwise, you have to assume, as I was mentioning, that the space of parameter is separable. This is the easiest thing to do. And I remind you that saying that the space is separable just means that there is some countable and dense subset with respect to the metric D, of course, in capital T. Now, of course, if you have a process which is almost surely continuous, then its supremum on the full space is also equal to the supremum on the countable dense subset. And again, you are allowed to speak about the expectation of the soup, which is merely the soup of the expectation of the soup of XT over all the finite subset of T. It's the two equivalent ways of speaking of the expectation of the soup. Either it is the expectation of the soup on the countable dense subset, or it is the soup of the expectation of the soup on the finite possible subsets of capital T. It is the same. So you should understand that it's not clear at all that for a Gaussian process, you will always find almost surely continuous version of it. It's not clear at all. But nevertheless, even though there is no continuous version of the process, you always have some regularity. Yes?
Qu'est-ce que c'est grand T? Grand T, c'est quoi? Grand T,
c'est a priori n'importe quoi. C'est un ensemble. C'est une sorte de structure.
Pas T.
This guy.
Non.
Capital T.
Non, T.
T, c'est ça. T, c'est ça.
Je ne sais pas comment prononcer la lettre. T. Non, T.
Je crois qu'il parle de la distance D.
Ah, ça ici, la distance D ici.
Grand T. Grand T.
Alors, excuse-moi, grand T, c'est ça, grand T. Ça, c'est un grand T.
Non.
Ah, grand D. C'est grand D dont tu parles, lui?
Oui.
Grand D. OK. Donc, grand D, c'est un sous-ensemble qui est dénombrable et dense dans grand T.
Ouais. C'est, ok, monsieur, la prochaine fois, lorsque je voudrais prononcer T, je vais dire T comme la prochaine fois, je vais dire T comme Donna, ok?
Oui, d'accord.
Difficile pour les Chinois.
Bon, ok, je comprends. Anyway, so capital D here, I tell you again that capital D is a countable and dense subset in capital T, okay? And this is precisely the separability assumption that subset of this nature does exist, okay? So as I was saying, just speaking of separability, because of the essence of the pseudo distance, which is linked to the L2 distance between on the increment of the process, this means that saying that this set is separable already means something about regularity. More precisely, you can always, by invoking Chebyshev and Borel-Cantelli, you can always build a sequence Tk here such that the distance between T and Tk is less than 1 over k. And this means that for this distance, by Bien-Aimé-Chebyshev, for this sequence, excuse me, by Bien-Aimé-Chebyshev and Borel-Cantelli, you end up with the fact that x of tk converges to x of t almost surely as k tends to infinity. So you do not have the full continuity because you do not know that for any sequence, the x of tk converges to x of t as k goes to infinity, but you know that there are some subsequences for which it is true. Okay? So as I was saying, apart from the countable case where the things are completely clear, in the full generality, it is not possible to ensure that the almost sure sample continuity of the process will hold. And instead of that, we have to consider some version of the process. Some version will be possibly continuous and some other will possibly be not continuous. So you have to consider some special version of the process. And there's special versions that I call X tilde here will have the same distribution as X, but will be different from X. And the preceding remark allows you to build versions of the process by modifying the process itself, starting from its value on the countable set, and then extend it to the full space, to the full set, to the full parameter space. So more precisely, what I mean is that if you have X tilde, which is continuous on the full set X, and which coincides with X on D, then automatically X tilde coincides with X on each finite set because of the preceding property of existence of sequence for which we have regularity. And therefore X tilde is a version of X. So this introduces you to a very simple way of building versions of X which will be almost surely continuous by modifying versions, by modifying the process, starting from its value on the countable and down subset. This is the way we shall do to build continuous versions. So another consequence of the preceding remark is that if the sample are almost surely bounded, then the parameter set is bounded. So more precisely, let's see the statement. If the set T equipped with a distance D is separable, and if the process happens to be bounded, then it implies that the soup of the expectation of x square t is finite. Okay, so let's see that. If the process is almost surely bounded, this means that a fortiori it is bounded on a countable subset. But if it is the case on the countable subset, you can speak about the soup of XT as a random variable. It's actually measurable, so there is no problem. And so this means that this quantity is almost surely bounded. Now, given a point T in a capital T, we know from the preceding remark of weak continuity that XT will be almost surely less than Z. Okay, because you always have a subsequence which is such that X of this subsequence will go to XT and the sequence belonging to D. So this means that you have this XT, which is always smaller than the soup on the countable and dense subset, almost surely. And now if you choose a percentile, you take on this variable, you take some number such that the probability that the variable is larger than this number is less than 1/4 here. If you look at the maximal variance of the Gaussian process, if it is equal to zero, there is nothing to say, but if it is positive, then you may write that the probability that the soup is less than small z is greater than three quarter, because you know that by definition, this quantity here is defined by the fact that the tail is smaller than a quarter. So it is larger than three quarters.
Monsieur, oui. Comment choisir pour petit tail? Pouvez-vous montrer la page dernière? Comment choisir petit z?
Petit z is a percentile. It is a number which is such that the tail of the variable is less than 1/4. Okay?
Sigma t, c'est.
Sigma t is just the sigma t square is just the variance.
Okay, variance. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, c'est bon.
So you have that the probability that z is less than small z is larger than 3/4. So I recall you that z is the supremum of XT on the countable and dense subset. It is also less than the probability that XT is smaller than small z, because we do know that XT is less than z, almost surely, and for all t in capital T. This is what we have said before. And so this is nothing else than the distribution function of the standard normal taken at point Z over sigma t. And at the end, this means that sigma t is less, has to be less than Z over the number, which is explicit, and which is the inverse of the distribution function of the Gaussian at point Z over 4. So it is what it is, but it is a number. So this means that sigma t is less than a fixed number for all t. So you have a uniformly bounded variance. Okay? So this is quite a subtle argument. You should think about it, but this is an argument which is important for what follows. So if I summarize, I show you again this statement here. This statement tells you that if the process happens to be bounded almost surely, then it implies that the variance has to be uniformly bounded. So it's quite a strong result in some sense. So if you combine this result with the Gaussian concentration theorem, that we have seen and its consequence on suprema that we have seen last time. It has a very useful consequence in this case, of course. Okay, so the nice consequence is as follows. You have now an infinite dimensional version of the result that you have seen last time. We have seen it in dimension, in finite dimension, but it extends to the general case by the following statement. So if the set of parameters happens to be separable, and if the process happens to be almost surely bounded and continuous, then the soup of Xt, we can speak of it, it's in this case, it is a measurable quantity. And the good surprise is that as soon as it is bounded, it is integrable. The variance, the maximal variance has to be finite. This is a preceding result. And of course, we have that the Z minus its expectation is sub-Gaussian with a variance factor, which is equal to sigma squared. So let's see why we have this. It's just combining the things that we have seen. So the fact that the maximal variance is finite comes from the preceding statement. And the Gaussian concentration theorem implies that the results that we have stated above is true for all quantities x of t, t belonging to capital F with a finite set. So by monotone convergence, we extended to the situation where we look at this time the countable case. So we extended to xt with t belonging to d and d countable. This is just monotone convergence. And then the continuity tells you that the soup on d, this is the same as the soup on t, and you get the final result. So you see the power here of the concentration theorem, the finite dimensional concentration theorem. Its power is in the fact that the way the process is increasing with the set of parameters does depend only on the soup, on the expectation of the soup, and on nothing else. Okay. So if for some reason you get it under control, then you have the infinite dimensional version of the concentration, which is with you. Okay. Okay. So let's go to a concept which will be important for us in the statistical part of the of today's lecture. And it is a concept of isonormal process. So let's think about it as a natural extension of the notion of a standard normal random vector to an infinite dimensional setting. So the definition is as follows. You take some separable Hilbert space, and a Gaussian process is said to be isonormal if it is centered with a covariance which is given by the scalar product. So let's see that this is a usual concept when we take the finite dimensional situation. When we take the case where the Hilbert space is finite dimensional, if you start from a standard normal random vector, then if you associate to it just by duality the random variable W, which is just the scalar product between J and Xi, you get a W, which is indeed an isonormal process. So the finite dimensional situation, you recover the same concept as the concept of standard normal random vector, except that you see it from the duality perspective. This is the only novelty. Okay, so of course, just because of the fact that the orthonormal process is preserving the scalar product. That is, you have the scalar product in the Hilbert space, to which corresponds the L2 scalar product between the W images. This means that you have also almost sure linearity, but take care that it holds for a given finite collection of vectors. More precisely, if you take some linear combination of vectors of the Hilbert space, then you use the preservation of the scalar product in order to say that the expectation of the L2 distance square between W of J and W of the combination is equal to zero. And this means that almost surely W of J is equal to the sum of the alpha J, W of JJ. Well, so W is linear as a map from the Hilbert space into L2 of omega. So take care to the fact that here there are some negligible sets which depend on the parameters. More precisely, the fact that W is linear as a map from the Hilbert space to L2 does not mean that there exists a version of W which is almost surely linear on H as a map from H to R. Okay, so this is a notion of linearity which is a bit subtle, and you have to take care about the negligible sets. But nevertheless, it helps you, because now that you have noticed that you have an isometry between the Hilbert space and L2, this means that when you take a Hilbertian basis in the Hilbert space, then it is transformed via the isonormal, it is transformed into a sequence of IID standard normal variables, just because these variables will be Gaussian variables by definition, of course, and then they will be centered with a variance which is equal to one, and the orthogonality between these variables would imply the fact that they are independent because of the Gaussian character of each random vector that you can build from the sequence. Okay, so you have this sequence of IID standard normal. And now what is interesting is that you can apply the three series theorem in order to warrant that the expansion of W of J into a sum of coefficients J scalar product with phi J times xi J, this expansion here, which holds in L2, of course, by definition, because you have an isometry, it also holds almost surely. So the situation here is a bit funny, because you have this sequence here, which belongs to small L2, and this one, which does not belong to small L2, because of course, a sequence of standard normal, when you look at the sum of the squares, in expectation, it's always equal to plus infinity. And so the sequence does not belong at all to small L2. But nevertheless, it makes sense to look at something which looks like a scalar product in L2. Okay, this is the magic of the three series theorem. Okay, so I just have written on the slide what I have said some seconds ago. So you have something which looks like a scalar product in small L2, but it isn't, because the sequence Xij does not belong to small L2, but nevertheless, the series converges almost surely. So the difference between the finite dimensional situation is that you cannot represent your W as a scalar product between a random element which would belong to the Hilbert space and J. You cannot represent your W like that. But apart from that, it will work exactly as in the finite dimensional situation. It will be possible to work with white noise, having in mind that it looks like a standard normal random vector, but viewed from the duality perspective. Okay, so you have this sequence of IID random variables, which plays a role of the vector, the role of the standard normal random vector in finite dimension. And you have this series here, which plays the role of the scalar product in finite dimension. So conversely, you can always build an isonormal process starting from an IID standard normal sequence, and then defining W of J as its expansion. And it's easy to check that it is indeed an isonormal process. So now that we have built this isonormal process, we have defined it, and you have given some ways to build it, we want to study continuity sets, that is, sets for which you can guarantee that there exists some continuous version of it. So of course, if you take a finite dimensional subspace of the Hilbert space, you do know that it is the case, because on the subspace, on a linear finite dimensional subspace, you know that W is almost surely linear and therefore continuous on capital S. But of course, this is not the general situation. And thanks to a very beautiful definite criterion found by Talagrand, it's possible to completely characterize the totally bounded sets of H on which W admits an almost surely continuous version. But I don't want to enter into these details here because it is very technical and we do not shall use it really in practice. But I rather prefer to focus on the ellipsoids, because this is a situation that we shall study afterwards in the statistical part of the lecture. So for ellipsoids, in fact, it's quite easy to analyze ellipsoids for which a continuous version does exist. And the statement is as follows: an ellipsoid will be a continuity set if and only if, this is the result by Dudley here. So an ellipsoid is a continuity set if and only if it is Hilbert-Schmidt, that is the sequence Xij belongs to small L2. And if you consider, so if it is the case, if you consider a version of the isonormal process which is continuous on the ellipsoid, then you have two interesting things. First, the fact that the expectation of the soup square is equal to the sum of the Xij square. And you also have an idea of the modulus of continuity via the fact that the expectation of the soup square is less than subtail here, a quantity which is related to the sequence size j. And this soup is taken over what? Over the increment between j and h when j and h belong to the ellipsoid. That's one point. And they are close from a quantity which is small sigma. And of course, the important point here is that, as you see, this tends to zero. This quantity here tends to zero as sigma tends to zero, because you are in the Hilbert-Schmidt case, that is, this series is convergent, and so the tail tends to zero. So let's see a proof of this. It's not that complicated, but we have to see it carefully. So, oops. Ellipsoids as continuity set. So if some ellipsoid is indeed a continuity set, this means that there exists some version of the isonormal process which is almost surely continuous. On the epsilon. And since it is continuous, it is bounded. Because an ellipsoid is compact. Space. And then by the concentration theorem that we have seen, this implies that Z, which is the soup of W of J in the ellipsoid, is square integrable. It is integrable, it is a square integrable, it has moments of any order because of the concentration theorem. So now when you look at the value of this soup, you can use the representation that you have mentioned. As the sum of the j, phi j times xi j. Xi j's are merely the W of phi j and the sequence of IID standard normals. Phi j are just a Hilbertian basis. Of the Hilbert space H. So now, when you look at this formula, You know by Cauchy-Schwarz that it is less than the sum of the j phi j of over cj squared times the sum of the cj squared xi j squared. But you know also that it is achieved at some point. So you know that this supremum is achieved at j equals the sum of psi j xi j over the square root of the sum of the ck square xi k square. And therefore, the soup, this soup here, this quantity z, is nothing else than the sum of the cj square, psi j square. And so the fact that it is almost surely finite, we know that it is almost surely finite, implies that it is integrable. It's just our argument before. By the Gaussian concentration sur M. And this means that the expectation of the sum of psi j square, has to be finite. And of course, this is equal to the sum of psi j square by Hamiltonian convergence. So this means that continuity implies Hilbert-Schmidt. So now we have to prove the converse. So conversely, if the sequence psi j belongs to small l2, we take E prime 2 to be a countable and dense subset of the ellipsoid. We have to take care now with the quantities which are soup of somebody, because we are no longer in a situation where you are continuous. So you do not know in advance that this quantity will make sense. So you have to work with countable subsets on which you have no problems. So we take a countable subset and we look at the same expansion as before, but on this countable subset. So you have the right to consider it a discountable subset. You look at that for all j belonging to the ellipsoid, but the countable subset of the ellipsoid. And of course, you may use now Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Same argument as before, but in the reverse sense. And this means that the sum of the j, phi j, xij square is less than the sum of the j phi j over psi j square. Times the sum of the psi j square. And of course, because you belong to the ellipsoid, j belongs to the ellipsoid, this quantity here is less than one. So this means that if you look at z prime, which is the soup of j belonging to the countable subset of the ellipsoid of the sum of the j phi j xi j, the expectation of z prime square is less than the sum of the psi j square, just because here in expectation this is equal to the sum of the psi j square. And of course, we are in a situation where this is finite. So you have this on a countable and dense subset. So we keep this in mind. And now we look at the increments. So we look at the quantity e prime to sigma of c, which is the collection of increments between elements of the countable and dense subset of the ellipsoid, but which are at a distance which is less than sigma. And we notice that this e prime two sigma of c is itself included in an actual ellipsoid, which is the ellipsoid with the sequence that I denote by capital L, where capital L G J, excuse me, is equal to 2 times square root of 2 cj infimum with sigma. Because this means simply that if you belong to the ellipsoid, when you look at the increments, they also belong to the ellipsoid, but you have to increase slightly the radius. And still you are in a in a situation where the you are included in some ellipsoid. So now you can use the preceding result, which holds true for any countable subset of an ellipsoid. And so this means that the expectation of the soup of W of small w belonging to this e prime two sigma of c square is less than 8 times the sum of psi j square infimum with sigma square. And this represents the sum of the Lj square. So we apply the preceding result just because this guy here is included in some actual ellipsoid. And now, since we know that the square root of the sum of the psi j square infimum with sigma square is a quantity which tends to zero when sigma decreases to zero, you may define a sequence which decreases to zero, which is such that the sum of the series converge. And you combine Markov's inequality with the Borel-Cantelli lemma to ensure that W is almost surely continuous and even uniformly continuous in this case on the E prime 2 of C set, that is the countable subset that we have taken in the ellipsoid. And now we use the density into the density, the fact that it is dense in E2, to extend the continuous path of W from E prime 2 to E2. And from the general remark that we have done at first, that we made, this means that W is indeed this extension is actually a version of W. Okay, so the things are going like that. If you look at a countable subset of the ellipsoid, automatically any version of W will be almost surely uniformly continuous in this countable and dense subset. And now you take the passes which are uniformly continuous, and you extend these passes to the whole ellipsoid with a deterministic procedure. And the remark that we have made is that this automatically leads to the construction of a version of W. This is indeed a version of W. So now the proof is almost finished because all the hard work is done. When we take version of W, a version of the isonormal process, a version W of the isonormal process. Which is actually continuous on A2 of C, then all the inequalities before that we have proved before on E prime hold true on E2. Because the supremum of W of W or the increments of W on E prime 2 are also equal to the supremum on E2. It's the same because you have continuous paths and the density of E prime 2 in E2. So you look at the soup, it is true, and the, for the increments, it is the same thing. So the inequalities that we have proved also hold true for E2. So this means that we have proved our statement. The full statement it is with these two inequalities here, this one and this one. We have proved them for E prime, and this is the same for E2 by a continuous extension. Okay, so I think it's a good point to make a coffee break, since afterwards I shall start with the statistical part of the lecture. So we stop here, take a break, and see each other again in 5 or 10 minutes. See you. So let us continue. And now that we know what is a Gaussian process in full generality, now that we know what is an isonormal process.
Monsieur, est-ce que vous avez vu mon message, mes messages?
We shall speak about that at the end, okay?
Okay.
So now that we know that, we can introduce the abstract white noise framework, which consists of observing a process which is defined by duality in some sense as a scalar product between F and J, F being a target which is to be estimated in the Hilbert space H, plus epsilon times W of J. W is now as in an isonormal process according to the definition that we gave on the separable space H. And as I mentioned, F is the target that we want to estimate. So this is a convenient framework because it allows to cover both finite dimensional and infinite dimensional situations. So let's see that in details. Of course, it allows to interpret the usual white noise model that you have seen in these terms here. In some sense, it's done like, to do that. And so here, simply the isonormal process is the stochastic integral of J against the Brownian motion. So in some sense, it's a way of defining the stochastic integral that, excuse me, come back to the slide. Okay, so you have this W of J here. Which is the integral of J against the Brownian motion here. And in the finite dimensional situation, your isonormal process will just be defined by duality starting from a standard normal random vector as we did before. So let's see more precisely the examples. So the first one is the usual white noise model. So in this case, if you start from the stochastic equation here, then you define your W as mentioned before, as the stochastic integral, and you get an isonormal process on L2 of 0,1. And in some sense, this W is closely related to the Brownian motion because conversely, if you take an abstract isonormal process on L2 of 0,1, and if you look at a continuous version of it on the set of indicator functions zero x, then you create again a Brownian motion. So isonormal process on L2 of 0,1 allows you to define these quantities here, and it allows you also to define the Brownian motion. So you can start from the Brownian motion and define the isonormal process, or you can do conversely, you can do the converse, you can start from an isonormal process and define the Brownian motion. Okay, and next, the observed process fulfilling the white noise, the abstract model, the white noise model is merely the integral of J against the process psi. So you see the link between the two. It's the link which is done via duality, via the computation of the integral here. So now let's turn to the classical linear Gaussian regression framework. So in this case, you merely look at observations which are independent and structured in this way. You have a constant here, fj, plus sigma eta j, and eta j, the variables eta j are merely IRD standard normal. So this is the usual Gaussian regression framework. And if you equip Rn with a scalar product, which is the usual one, but normalized by 1 over n, and if you normalize in the same way your W here, you take the scalar, this scalar products normalized by root n this time, then you make appear an isonormal process by just taking the scalar product between J and Y, and it satisfies to the model that has been defined at the very beginning of the section with a level of noise, which is simply sigma over square root of n. So it allows you to put the usual linear Gaussian regression model into the white noise framework. Now, let's see a model which is somewhere between the preceding two, as I will explain you. And this is the fixed design regression framework in which you have a classical Gaussian regression model, but with the particularity that the FJ are a function, represent a function which is taken at point J over N. This means that you have some hidden function here that you want to estimate, and you see it at some points. And in this case, you also, similarly to the Gaussian white noise, you also have a signal to estimate, but the observations this time are discrete. And so you have a noisy signal, which is observed at time G over N. So of course, there is a link with the white noise. In some sense, you are in a situation where you have a discrete version of the white noise. So let's see that in details. If you start from the white noise and you discretize it, that is, you look at the increments between the Brownian motion between time J over N and J minus one over N, and you normalize it in order to get standard normals. Then the quantity of signal that you receive at time J over N is the difference between the process, the continuous process at time J over N and the continuous process at time J minus one over N. And of course you normalize by N because it's a mean. And so you recover a YJ, which is equal to N time no, here it's not the right integration bound. J minus one over N and J over N. There is a mistake, sorry. And since the variables are ID standard normals, you are back to a fixed design Gaussian regression framework. But this time, the FJ will represent the piecewise constant function Fn here, taken at G over N. And this piecewise constant function is just equal to these mean values that we have seen here on each interval, J minus one over N, J over N. And so you see that the link here is made through an approximation of the original function f by its piecewise constant approximation, which of course will be good if the function f is smooth enough. So what you have to keep in mind here is that the fixed design regression model, you can see it as a discretized usual white noise model. So another way to transform the usual Gaussian white noise model into a discrete model is to filter it on some orthonormal basis. So you can do it also for the abstract white noise. So this means that you start from your white noise model, your abstract white noise model, and you take some orthonormal basis phi j. And now you filter your white noise model on it. This means that you keep the coefficients y epsilon of phi j that you denote by beta hat j, and you look at it. So they are structured like that. It is a scalar product between f and phi j plus epsilon w of phi j. And of course, the w of phi j, which appears since you are filtering your isonormal process, this means that you will keep variables which are IID standard normals. So this means that the sequence here that you get is structured in the following way. The beta hat j are equal to the beta j. The beta j are the usual coefficients of the function on the Hilbert base, plus some noise, which is epsilon times eta j, and the eta j variables are IID standard normal. So this means that you have here a statistical framework which looks very much as the finite dimensional Gaussian classical framework, but here the difference is that you have a sequence instead of a finite number of observations, but otherwise it is exactly the same structure. So you see again that this abstract Gaussian white noise allows you to look at finite dimensional as well as infinite dimensional situations. This is its flexibility, which makes it attractive. So now let's see some concrete model selection issues. So one of the most important model selection problem is variable selection. So what is variable selection? Let's look at it in its natural version in some sense. So you look at the finite dimensional Gaussian regression framework, the usual one. And usually in this framework, you assume that the mean vector belongs to some capital N dimensional subspace of Rn, some smaller subspace. And equivalently, this means that you can write F as a combination of some vectors, phi j, again. And you want to recover F, or you want to detect what are the variables, phi j, which explain the best, excuse me, I've made some stupidity here. You want to understand what are the most significant variables in this expansion of F. So in this situation, the variables are given by nature in some sense, and you want to analyze what is the most influential variables on the phenomenon that you are studying. But it also makes sense to look at this variable selection from another perspective, that is in the situation of the white noise model, because in this signal denoising problem, the variables can represent some linear functions in L2 of 0,1 that you want to use to reconstruct your unknown signal. So there's variables can be part of a Hilbertian base, for instance. So if you think at a situation where precisely you take phi lambda, the set of variables are a large subset of a wavelet basis. A wavelet basis is a special example of Hilbertian base of L2 of 0,1. Then you would like to select some ideal subset of these variables in order to represent the signal. So this means that the complete variable selection problem here is of interest in a variety of situations. What we call complete variable selection means that you are allowed to look at any subset of the set of variables that you are looking at. So it's interesting if nature has given to you the variables, but it's also interesting when you have built your variables by yourself by deciding that you keep looking at wavelets or some other type of functions. Why not looking at neural networks, for instance? You are building your idea of what is interesting for you to reconstruct your signal, and you are in a situation where you want to select the best variables in order to represent it. So this is a problem of variable selection. A related problem, and which appears also naturally in geophysics, for instance, is to select the best partition by intervals which are made on a regular grid like that. And this is a multiple chain point detection, which we are looking at here. And the unknown signal that you want to estimate is represented by some piecewise constant on these intervals built on the grid here. And so here, the issue is to select the best partition. Your model is made of piecewise constant functions on partitions, and you get the game here consists of selecting the best partition. So I have used a quite vague vocabulary by talking about most significant variables or best partition, but now we are in a situation where we have to be more precise by what we mean by best partition or best set of variables, most significant set of variables. And this is the issue that you want to address now. And we would like to enter into the world of giving mathematics behind these vague concepts. So the concept that we shall study in detail is the concept of quadratic risk. So here we introduce the L2 distance in capital H, which is of course a natural distance. And we look at the analog of least squares in this abstract situation. The idea is that if you look at the deterministic situation, approximating at best some element of the Hilbert space by somebody in some subset SM is done through the minimization of the L2 distance. And if you minimize the L2 distance, it's equivalent to minimize the norm square minus 2 times the scalar product. You don't need to put plus F square here. So when you look at its noisy version amounts to replace the scalar product by the noisy process here, Y epsilon of J. So this is done. And this is the least square criterion. And you can easily check that this least square criterion is good. That is, when you look at the minimum of the value of expectation of this criterion, the minimum is achieved at point F. Or equivalently, when you look at the difference in expectation between the criteria, they are equal to a non-negative quantity, which is computable. And in this case, you recover simply the L2 square distance between F and J. So this means that L epsilon is indeed an empirical risk criterion of the nature that we have introduced before. So now, an empirical risk minimizer of this criterion will be called the B squares estimator. And model selection now will proceed in 2 steps. First step, considering some collection of models, of course, and then representing each of these models by the least squares estimator, which are defined on them. And now we want to use the data to define a way of selecting a plausible value of the model. And for us, selecting the best model will amount to select the best estimator, and the best estimator according to the criterion of the risk. That is, the risk of estimation will be our benchmark to decide if the model is good or not. For us, model is good means that the corresponding estimator is good. So the benchmark, our grail, is this infimum here, the infimum of the quadratic risk. This is the oracle risk. And again, I insist on the fact that this concept of oracle here is different from the concept of a true model. Remember the computation that we have done. It's sometimes better to take a model which is slightly false, but with a reasonable number of parameters. On the contrary, a true model with a huge number of parameters should be prohibited. So we turn now to the issue of selecting linear models. This issue will not be the final goal of the lecture because we shall also consider in the future of the course nonlinear models, but nevertheless, linear models are very important because they are very important in practice, first, and second, there are many, many examples that you can study with these linear models. And approximation theory allows you to play with linear models in order to build some nonlinear selection procedures. So it also plays a role in curve estimation. This is what I mean. Okay, so nevertheless, let's start with a linear subspace with dimension dm of the Hilbert space. Then the least square estimator in this case can be computed explicitly. It is merely equal to the sum of the noisy coefficients on the basis phi j, where phi j is the given orthonormal basis. It's, oops, excuse me. Here you have a finite dimensional basis. It's not a Hilbert basis. Here it's a finite dimensional basis. So you can compute f hat of m. So this is the same computation as before. You expand the least square criterion here, and you end up with an optimization in R to the power dm, and with the constant gamma j here. And you simply look at this as a function of gamma, and you see that the minimum of the criterion is achieved at gamma being equal to the noisy coefficients. So it's easy to see here that the minimum of the least square criterion is achieved at this very point. And now we can analyze the risk. You just expand the noisy coefficient as its deterministic part here, plus the random part, which is a Gaussian part. The W of phi j are, of course, IID standard normal because you have an isonormal process. And now f hat m, which is the least square estimator on the finite dimensional space SN, appears as a projection estimator, as an empirical projection estimator. That is, you look at an expansion which looks very much like the projection, the deterministic projection, which is here, but apart from the fact that the true coefficients here are replaced by the noisy coefficients. So this is quite satisfactory. And the difference between the two, in fact, between the estimator and the projection, is merely equal to epsilon times the sum of the W of phi j times phi j. And this allows you to compute explicitly the quadratic risk. And you recover exactly the same formula as in the usual white noise, despite of the fact that you are working with the abstract white noise, it is the same formula. You get a quadratic risk, which is the sum of a bias term here and of a variance term. So now I would like to explain you where does the idea of penalization comes from. So this is an important step of the course. So despite of the fact that it is a bit late this morning, and probably you are tired, I would like you to listen to me carefully at this stage, because there is an important idea that I would like to explain to you. This idea is the idea introduced by people like AKK in Malos in the 70s. And this is the idea of estimating the risk. If you want this risk to be under control, and you want to design a data-driven strategy to keep it under control, the natural idea consists of trying to estimate this quantity and then optimize this estimated quantity. The main difficulty here is that this bias is not easy at all to estimate. Why is it difficult to estimate? It is difficult because you have this possibly infinite dimensional part here, which is given by F. So this bias, at first glance, is almost as difficult to estimate as F itself. So what's the point to estimate the bias rather than F? It's not easier to do. And this is the main difficulty. So there is this beautiful idea introduced by Malos that I would like to explain to you right now. And this is the idea of unbiased risk estimation. And Malos' heuristics to propose a penalized criterion goes like that. Basically, his idea is to estimate unbiasedly the risk. And he says that this minimization of the quadratic risk is, of course, equivalent to the following one. That is, if you subtract F square here, you have Pythagore who is working with you. And Pythagore tells you that the bias square minus F square is merely equal to minus the norm square of Fm. And now the story is very different, because instead of getting a quantity which is infinite dimensional, potentially here, you have this quantity who is defined from a finite dimensional guy, which is a projection of F onto the model SM. And the idea of Malos is to start from this formula and to propose an unbiased estimator of this quantity, and then propose a criterion which is based on this unbiased estimator. This is the idea. So let's do it now by hand. Excuse me. Whoop. Let's go to the blackboard and try to explain to you Malos' heuristics. So the trick now is that we estimate the norm square of Fm instead of the bias. This is the trick. So if we go naively, let's go naively. Any idea for estimating this guy? I've got one. Let's try to plug FATM instead of FM. Okay, this is a candidate. What about this one? This is a candidate. Let us analyze its value in expectation. What is the expectation of this guy? Well, let us expand this guy in this way. We say that it is the norm square of F at M minus FM plus FM. This is the norm square. So this is equal to FM square, which is the quantity that we want to estimate. That's nice. Plus the expectation of F at M minus FM square. Mm-hmm. Plus 2 times the expectation of F at M minus FM scalar product with FM. This guy here is nothing else than epsilon times the sum between F and phi j, F scalar product with phi j, W of phi j. So this is centered at expectation. So this is equal to zero. Okay, so this guy disappears, but this guy not. But this guy, we have seen it already. We know it already. We know that this guy here we perfectly know it. It's equal to epsilon square dm. This is a computation that we have done already. Oh, so this means that at the end of the day, our candidate is not that good as we thought, because it is equal to the target plus this guy here. So it is better to remove this bias of estimation that we know. So it's better to estimate Fm square by F hat m square minus dm epsilon square. And now, finally, to minimize the risk, as mentioned before, we should minimize minus FM square plus epsilon 2 dm. And if we estimate FM square by F hat m square minus dm epsilon square, we end up with Mallows CP. It's the criterion defined by Mallows, which is called Mallows CP, and which is simply minus F hat m square plus 2dm epsilon squared. And you see that this 2dm epsilon squared comes from this guy plus this guy. Okay? So just a remark before going back to the slides. You should notice, remark, if you analyze this criterion here, you could wonder what is the relationship with what I have told you from the very starting point. That is, I told you that L epsilon F hat of M should be the guy that you should penalize. So what is the relationship between this minus F hat of M square and this guy here, the least square criterion taken at its minimum? It turns out that it is the same, in fact. Because when you compute the value of y epsilon computed as f hat of m, this is y epsilon of the sum of between 1 and dm of the y epsilon phi j phi j. So this is equal to the sum of the y epsilon of phi j square. So this is merely the norm square of f at m. So when you compute the criterion L hat of L epsilon of F hat M, this is equal to the norm square minus two times Y epsilon of F hat M. And this is equal to minus F hat M square. So it turns out that this minus F hat M square is merely the value of the least square criterion taken at its minimum. Okay, so it's indeed what has been announced. The method proposed by Mallows is a penalized empirical risk minimization. Because it amounts to take the minimum over the collection of the infimum of the criterion within the model, plus some penalty. In the Mallows case, the penalty is equal to 2 epsilon squared dm. And the infimum of Lj, j belonging to Sm, is merely equal to minus F at m squared. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. Okay, so now I would like to give you a first result. This is a model selection theorem. And this model selection theorem will be a special case of a more general theorem that we shall prove together. It's a special case when the models are linear. So I start with linear models because things are much easier to understand in this framework, but be patient. Afterwards, we shall turn to general models. But for the moment, we are considering linear models. And this first model selection theorem will consist of building a risk bound with a penalty, with a penalized least square procedure, which will, in some sense, validate or invalidate Malo's heuristics. What is good with Malo's heuristics is that you have this guideline of estimating the risk unbiasedly. What is not good is that the underlying philosophy is to minimize things in expectation for each given M. Or, but of course, what you have to do is to optimize a criterion along a list of models. So you would like these evaluations to be quite uniform with respect to M. So in some sense, when you say that this quantity here has an expectation, which is this quantity there, each time you say that this quantity is a good estimator of this one, you say you make an error. And this error can be added all along the procedure of minimization if the list is huge. So the idea in the behind the theorem that I am stating now is that it may happen that you need to correct the Malo's heuristics because of this effect of searching a model in a huge list. So I turn to the statement. Here is the statement of the theorem. This is a result that I have proved with my colleague and friend Lucien Berger in 2000. And this theorem says the following thing. Let's take a family of weights which are such that the sum of the exponential of minus these weights is less than infinity. And let's call it some capital sigma. You take some quantity capital K, which is strictly larger than one, and the penalty, which is greater than what you would expect, that is a quantity which is proportional to, excuse me, there is a missing square here, it's terrible. So you see that if the XM were not there here, the penalty would be proportional to the number, to the dimension of the model, which is quite usual. But what makes the criterion unusual is the addition of this possibly small, but possibly not small quantity XM. So this correction is new with respect to what people had in mind at this period. So you consider the minimized least square criterion, so just as Malo's, but with this modified penalty here. And when you what you put here as a penalization, you find it in the risk, that is, at the end of the day, when you look at the penalized least square estimator, this penalized least square estimator follows a risk bound, which has the following nature. You see the infimum appearing between the bias, okay, so that's nice. And you do not exactly recover what you would like, that is something like epsilon squared dm, but you find what you put in the machine, that is you find the penalty. And apart from that, you have a corrective term, which does not play a big role here, which is proportional to epsilon squared. So the main part is here. And this main part looks very much like what you would like, that is a comparison with the oracle, apart from the fact that there are these strange quantities here, that correct the DM that you would expect. And you can wonder now what is the role of these weights. So we shall not prove the theorem today, and we shall not prove it under this statement. We shall prove it under a much more general statement that we shall give afterwards, which will englobe nonlinear models also. We shall get it as a corollary. So let us comment about the choice of the weights. So they have some kind of Bayesian flavor because if you look at it carefully, it's a way of putting a finite measure on the list of models. So it's some kinds of prior distribution on the list of models. So let's think about a reasonable way of choosing these weights. So this is not the only way, but a typical choice is to decide to penalize in the same way the models which have the same dimension, which is quite reasonable. So if you decide to do that, this means that the weight, you decide to take them as a function of the dimension. I do not say proportional to the dimension, I say a function of the dimension. Then if you do that, the sum of the exponential of minus xm becomes the sum over the dimension of the number of models with dimension d times the exponential of minus xd. So now you see that if you choose xd as some small proportion of d, possibly small proportion of d, you can decide it afterwards, plus the log of this number of models with dimension d, then you end up with a sum of exponential minus xm, which is under control. It is controlled by, this is a geometric series, exponential of minus alpha over 1 minus exponential minus alpha. So this is merely 1 over exponential alpha minus 1. So it is under control. So this means that when you look at this xd at the end, what is the choice that we have made? It is there. Here is the choice. And as you see, this choice is a small amount of the dimension. This is what you could expect. But here, the novelty with respect to what you could have in mind at first glance is this quantity here. And this quantity is the price that you pay for redundancy in your list. If you have many models with the same dimension, you will pay something which is due to the fact that you have in mind to take a huge list. So the huge list is paid here. So at the end, when you look at the penalty, so you are allowed to take a penalty as k epsilon square root of dm plus square root of 2x of dm square. So that the risk bound has the following form. It is like that. Some constant and the infimum over D of a quantity which is related to the bias that I call BD square of F plus the variance term, which is D epsilon square that you expect, and the correction, which is 2xd over D square. And the bias is the infimum over the model with dimension D of the individual bias on each models here. So this is clear that this is what you gain with redundancy. This is the gain that you have in your game. But here, conversely, XD is the price for redundancy. But since this price is paid through a log of number of models, you see that the price is rather modest as compared to the gain in some sense. So in particular, if you are able to warrant that XD is less than some constant times D, this means that the number of models is sub-exponential with respect to the number of parameters. Then the oracle, the inequality that we have become an oracle inequality, that is the inequality that we have in our pocket tells you that you are comparable with the oracle, up to a constant, of course. So this shows you that if things are going well with the weights, you have some hope to get a connection with what you want is, that is a comparison between the risk of the selected estimator and the grail, that is the oracle risk. This is what I wanted to show you at first glance. So this is what we have done here, that you have tried to see that there is some link with the oracle by choosing in an adequate way the weights. And this is a very good point to stop today's lecture. And next lecture, we shall go on these issues of linear model selection in the Gaussian framework and see the connection with adaptive estimation. So I say you bye-bye. I stop the recording.